Good morning.
Welcome to Hoare Valley United Church of Christ. I'm Reverend Drew Terry, and I am the pastor here. And here we say, whoever you are, wherever you are on life's journey, you are a beloved child of God. We are grateful that each and every one of you have joined us for worship and to celebrate life and love. I want to give a special welcome to any visitors with us, especially whether you're in person or online. If you are online, we are grateful that you've joined us this morning. We do hope and pray that you will be able to join us in person. Until then, we pray for you, and we are grateful that you've joined us how you are, where you are. For those of you in person, if you are newer with us, a few notes on our time together. As you came in, where you got your bulletin, there's little white gift bags. You're welcome to take one of those. We'd love for you to have one. It's got a lot of information about our church, about our United Church of Christ denomination, and our mission in Christ. And so please do pick one of those up. There's also little yellow cards in the seat back in front of you and in those white bag gift bags. And you can use that information to use that card to write us whatever information you feel comfortable sharing. Name, email address, phone number. And when the offering plate goes around, if you can put the yellow card in that, and we will use that to connect with you, give you a chance to share more about who you are, where you are in life's journey, and answer any questions about our mission. Welcome. Last invite I'll have is following worship. Everyone is welcome to join us across the parking lot in our fellowship hall for delicious treats and coffee and fellowship. So we hope and pray you're able to stick around for a little bit afterwards for a good time getting to know one another a little bit better. And if you need to know where our fellowship hall is on the other side of the parking lot, just ask somebody who's wearing a name tag or follow our children. They'll show you the way. Hey, I do turn your attention to the second page of your bulletin, just past your cover, where it says welcome and announcements. There's some announcements about our church and our life together. I do want to highlight a couple of them. First, I'm going to highlight one that's not even on there. Today is our Interfaith Community Service first Sunday of the month food drive, and as you can see on our altar, we've got some donation food, and I see in our entryway some food donated. Thank you to everyone who was able to contribute this month. You are a blessing, and we are grateful. If you miss this month, that's okay. Every first Sunday, we collect non-perishable food items. You can find a list either at Interfaith Community Services website, or you can reach out to our office, and we'd be happy to get you a list. But every first Sunday of the month, we collect food for the food pantry at Interfaith Community Services and to share bread and cup with our siblings in need. So thank you, everybody who participated this month, and look to do it again next month. And if you ever have food you'd like to drop off, you can just coordinate with our office. We'd be happy to take it at your convenience. The other announcement I'd like to point out this morning is our lunch fellowship. We will be doing our monthly lunch fellowship on Wednesday, this coming Wednesday, April 10th, at noon at Guadalajara, which is a Mexican restaurant on Ina and Oracle. So there's a big strip mall on the east side. Thank you. I knew somebody did their cardinal directions. On the east side of Oracle. If you need help finding it, just contact our office. We'd be happy to give you directions. We would like RSVPs. Please let us know if you're planning on coming by Tuesday morning. That way we can let Guadalajara know how many people are coming. We do have a few other announcements. I see Jay's got announcements.
Hi, good morning. If you would like an Easter lily, there are extras and they need to find a loving, caring, beautiful home. There's no more up there. But there's a lot over there in the corner, and maybe we can move them up if you want to take them. There's more in the narthex if you'd like to take them home. I understand some of you bought them and donated them. Anyone is welcome to take them home, even if you didn't buy one to have here. So they just need a really loving, pretty home. So I hope that's yours.
I'm going to invite Perry Foster forward. She's been leading our Thursday grief group, and she has a grief group announcement. It's an update.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
The pastor has generously given me 3 to 5 minutes to talk. So anyway, we do have a grief group here that is sponsored by Oro Valley Community Church, and it's doing really well. We're actually going into our fourth month, and the people that come, they are very blessed. I am very blessed, and I have seen tremendous healing in these people. So I would just encourage you, if at all you feel you need to talk to somebody or share something with somebody, the grief group then would be for you. Now, on that note, I want to say that the grief group is not just for people that are grieving over loved ones that have been lost or any substantial loss, but it's actually for anybody that has feelings of sadness, anger, loneliness, depression, anxiety, those kinds of things, which of course all of us have had at some point in our life, right? However, the key here is that if you are experiencing long-term suffering with any of these things that hold your mind in a prison, and you're waiting for that, like Pastor Drew said last week, that stone to be rolled away so you can enjoy the fullness and joy that God has for your life. This is called the feelings wheel. Now on here are over a hundred feelings and emotions that of course God has given us because he gave us emotions. You've got, most of these on here actually are ones that cause pain. There are about 40 of them that are happy emotions, but we're gonna this morning focus on the ones that make us feel bad. Like I said, the ones that are, you have sadness and the unforgiveness, jealousy. There is not one person, and I can confidently say this, on this whole planet, including Jesus, who has never ever experienced, even as young as 2 years old, some of these feelings. And they're normal because God gave us emotions and we're all in the human condition, right? So everybody at some point in their life has experienced these things. And again, I will say, if you are experiencing them on an ongoing basis, not a day, a week, a few hours, a month, but a long time, this is not healthy for your mind or your body or your soul. So if you really want to be free and have all the joy in your life that God has for you, I've made copies of this. They're on the little table out there. My name and phone number are on them. And I would encourage you to take one of those on your way out and just think about it. Try to, like the people in the group, they've taken off the mask, not the COVID mask, but the mask that we all wear sometimes that says, I don't want people to know who I really am because they might not like me. We all experience that, but in this group, there is no shame, there is no judgment at all. We love you, I love you, even if I don't know you. I deeply love you from my heart because God has given me this ministry and I want to share it with you. So take one of these, look at it and say to yourself, you know, I have been experiencing this for a long time and I would like to be free of it. Come to the grief group just once. There's no contracts to sign, there's no commitment, and it's free. So it's wonderful. I promise you that if you come once, you will want to come back again, really. So please pick up one of these on your way out. They're on the little table there. I will be in the fellowship hall after church, and if you would like to talk to me about anything, please do. I'm happy to hear you and hear what you have to say. And don't forget, no judgment and no shame. Why? Because we are all in the human condition, and we have all experienced these things. Thank you.
Well, as we end our time of community announcements and transition to our joys and celebrations around birthdays and anniversaries, I have a joy I would like to celebrate. We have for quite a while now been praying for Anne and all that she's been through. And if you don't believe in resurrection, Anne's with us this morning.
But thank you for the beautiful cards and warm wishes and prayers.
Oh, man, absolutely. That was such a joy to have you with us this morning. You are proof of resurrection. Thank you, Anne. I am so grateful. So in that joyous spirit of witnessing God's new life brought to us this morning, what birthdays and anniversaries would you like to bring into this space this morning to celebrate, to begin our worship? God just wants Anne to have the day. That's fine. That sounds great. I like it.
Anne, she just turned 85.
Hey! I think we should sing happy birthday.
Yeah.
Center ourselves in the presence of the Holy Spirit with a deep breath. And as we center ourselves in this space and in the Spirit, I invite us to stand as you are able in body or spirit and greet each other with a sign of Christ's peace. If you can't, give a wave to those at home.
Good morning.
Nothing like this has ever happened before.
But our resurrected Christ comes to us saying, here are the marks on my body.
Can we really believe that Jesus is here again?
Jesus breathes the Holy Spirit on us. Christ's peace is with us. We don't need to be afraid.
Our resurrected that Christ calls us to worship and receive the peace of Christ.
Let us worship with joy. Hallelujah.
Please hear these words of our opening prayer. Resurrected Christ, you have taught us how the unbelievable can be possible. When there is so much to fear in the world, we can find peace in your presence. As we worship, breathe your spirit on us that we may carry it with us. Help us comfort our neighbors. Help us serve a world of need. We pray this with thanksgiving for your work among us.
Amen.
Please remain standing as you are able as we sing our opening hymn. Join me in our prayer for transformation in new life. God, we confess that we too might be like Thomas, as we are overwhelmed by the world's grief. It's natural for us to be sinful. It's hard to believe that hope is possible when hope is hard to find. But when we stop believing in hope, we also stop believing the relations can be possible. We stop working to tear down injustice and discrimination. We stop others from experiencing the peace we have found in you. Forgive our unbelief, calm our fears, and help us be instruments of your peace. Amen. Please join me in our call and response. Words of grace and assurance of God's promise. The love of Jesus comes to us with grace, telling us we can believe. Because we believe, we can also be empowered to do the work of justice. Yes, the world is heavy. No, the work will never be done. But because we know Christ's peace, we can share it with others.
We believe in the grace and peace of Christ. We are forgiven. Hallelujah.
We now, in celebration of Holy Communion, and on this Sunday, recognizing that not only are we unique in God's image, but we are also all interconnected and interdependent in the Holy Spirit, and we celebrate that in reciting our United Church of Christ statement of faith.
So we will, we will all recite this together. We believe in God, the eternal Spirit, who is made known to us in Jesus our brother, and to those who need to testify. God calls the world into being, creates humankind in the divine image, and sets before us the ways of life and death. God God seeks in holy love to save all people from aimlessness and sin. God judges all humanity and all nations by that will of righteousness declared through prophets and apostles. In Jesus Christ, the man of Nazareth, our crucified and risen Lord, God has come to us and shared our common lot, conquering sin and death, and reconciling the whole creation to its Creator. God bestows upon us the Holy Spirit, creating and renewing the Church of Jesus Christ, binding in covenant faithful people of all ages, tongues, and races. God calls us into the Church to accept the cost and joy of discipleship, to be servants in the service of the whole human family, to proclaim the gospel to all the world and resist the powers of evil, to share in Christ's baptism and eat at his table, to join him in his passion and victory. God promises to all who trust in the gospel forgiveness of sins and fullness of grace, courage in the struggle for justice and peace, the presence of the Holy Spirit in trial and rejoicing, and eternal life in that kingdom which has no end, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto God. Amen.
We now enter into our covenantal sharing of the offering. And in this time, we take a prayerful moment to reflect and celebrate all the ways that God's abundant love has mysteriously poured out into our lives and empowered us in ways known and unknown to share life and love abundantly with others in all of God's creation. We celebrate all gifts, time, talent, and financial donations. If you do have a financial gift to share, if you are online, you can go to orvalleyucc.org. You can go to the My Offering button, you'll be a few clicks away that way. Or you can, on our homepage, scroll down to the bottom of the page and you'll find our mailing address and mail in a donation. If you're in person, we will pass the offering plate in just a second. And even as the plate goes around, if you don't have anything physical at this time to put into the plate, we do invite you to touch the plate and celebrate all the ways that God's love has been poured out into you and how you've been empowered to share that love in wonderful, amazing ways with the world. And all gifts go to help us be who God has made us and called us to be, a sanctuary and a safe space for everyone to gather and to worship life and love, and empowered by God's Holy Spirit to go down into the world to serve in love as Christ served in love. And so in that spirit, please join me in our invitation to the offering. Jesus has empowered us with the Holy Spirit. We have life because of his presence with us. Let us join in God's abundance, giving what we can to offer peace to a hurting world.
Thank you.
the resurrection, please help us use these gifts to offer hope where there is sorrow, peace where there is chaos, and love where there is fear. We can do incredible things because your spirit lives within us. Amen. The scripture reading for today is Acts 4:32 through 35. The community of believers was of one mind and one heart. None of them, not one, claimed anything as their own. Rather, everything was held in common. The apostles continued to testify with great power to the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and they were all given great respect. Nor was anyone needy among them, for those who owned property or houses would sell them and give the money to the apostles. It was then distributed to any members who might be in need. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Will you please join me in prayer? Dear God, the one whose love unites all life, to you and to all creation, come to you this day to be remade and renewed in your word. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, our God, our rock, and our redeemer. Amen. This is a really fun passage, probably one of my top passages, although I've recently discovered I say that a lot about a lot of passages. But it's definitely one of my favorites. Also, here's a fun thing. Normally, if you read my manuscripts and listen to my sermons, they're usually pretty close together. I would, even if you, but for anyone who does happen to read the manuscript that gets sent out on Wednesday, this might be a fun thing to compare to, because I'm not sure how close I'll be to the manuscript. I know it's on it, but I don't know if I'll say it. We'll see how the Spirit leads. But anyway, a couple of notes. One New Testament scholar, the New Testament professor I had in seminary, pointed out that this is a great passage because you'll listen to any biblical literalist in America. You can present this passage to them and they'll immediately be like, well, by all things in common, they didn't mean that. Or when they said sell their houses and sell all their property and gave the funds to the church, they didn't mean literally. So this is a good passage to mess up a literalist if you want to do that. But it's a really disturbing passage. It's a nice thought. It's a really fun idea. And especially for our Bible study. Our Bible study has really helped me with today's sermon because we've been working. We've been slowly journeying through the book of Acts. And this is at the very beginning. And there's this looming question in the book of Acts. Today is the second Sunday in Easter. I had fun with a neighbor recently explaining that Easter is very much like Christmas. We culturally celebrate these holidays before they actually happen, when liturgically in the church world, they don't start until the day of, right? And so we actually now, I believe it's 8 weeks. Somebody might correct me on that. Need fact check. I believe it's 8 weeks of Easter. So we get to celebrate Easter from now until Pentecost. But in the second Sunday of Easter, the question becomes, what is resurrection? Maybe even more poignantly, what does it mean to be community? What does it mean to be the people of God in light of the resurrection of Christ? And this is one of the earliest responses we have. Whoever wrote this, which is highly debated who wrote the book of Acts, but whatever early Christian thinker and observer wrote these words, observes a community in which this is happening. In which, yes, people are actually selling their property and giving all of the proceeds to the apostles who are running these communities. And they're distributing it amongst the poor, amongst the poor members of the community. Nobody is in need. This actually is not strange to the Bible. In fact, the reference, no one was in need, is a direct reference to Deuteronomy 15, verse 4. There shall be no one of need among you, God tells the people in Torah. And not only that, the radical, disorienting economics of Scripture continues in Torah, as well as is heard in this one in the book of Acts. A couple of ideas to throw at you that are in Torah but are highly debated. I want to give Jim, one of our church members and our frequent at coffee hour, he explained that many of these practices, it's debated whether or not the Israelites actually carried out with them, and if they did, how long. But still, they're good ideas. These ideas are a Sabbath year, a sabbatical year, if you will, every 7 years. And every 7 years, you have to cancel all debts. No questions asked. Doesn't matter if they're in deferment, doesn't matter, whatever. Whatever's going on. At 7 years, debt is canceled. At 7 years, slaves are set free, or they're converted into wage laborers, and they're compensated for their work. Every 7 years, you're supposed to let your land go fallow and rest, right? These are radical ideas. Here's another one. Jubilee. Every 50 years, this is where you think you're challenged already. Every 50 years, you get to go reclaim the land of your ancestors. You get to knock on somebody's door every 50 years and go, hey, you got this land from my great-grandfather, and guess what? I'm getting it back. Thanks. Awesome. God told me I could. Thank you. Yes. That's really disturbing. But again, even the Israelites and the ancient people struggled with these concepts. So what are we supposed to do with this information, right? And I think it is very much appropriate as we celebrate and live into the joy of this concept of resurrection. This idea of life after death, this totally, radically transformed reality. And that gives us context of grace, because the idea is that we don't have to get there to today. I mean, if you really are feeling inspired, do not let me get in the way of the Spirit, and you want to sell your house and donate to the church, I will introduce you to Rachel Koch, and she'll help you with that process. In the meantime, for the rest of us, myself included, the reality is, what does it mean to share all things in common? And it is. It's all levels. We often, I think it's easy for us to go metaphorical with it. Well, I share love, or I pray for you, I give this person my thoughts. And I don't want to say that that's not a part of this. They were of one mind and of one heart and of one spirit. Like, that is definitely a part of it. However, it's also more tangible. It's concrete as well. It's a both and. And I think that concrete, tangible part is our real growing edge as a culture. That's just a cultural reality. It might be true for other cultures too. So what do we do? How do we do it? And I want to share some spiritual learnings I've had over the past year working with this church and journeying with this church. And it also goes to a lot of the work I'm doing at the Isle of School of Theology right now. And it's this question of our needs, naming our needs, as well as being aware of the needs of those beyond our walls. And how do we enter relationship there? How do we step out of our own needs to share our gifts and our needs? How do we balance those things? And that's not easy. And for me, more tangibly, the question has been, how do we have an aging church population that has a lot of needs, right? You get older, you have more needs. That's a reality. The number of times churches, especially in our day and age, say they can't do anything because they're physically, or they just aren't, they're limited, right? So what do we do? First, we begin with recognizing who we are and the gifts we do have. The gifts that are abundant, once a month food drive. I mean, our food drive has been going on for quite some years now, predates me, and it's been a wild success. And it is a way for us to collect what gifts we have, our resources, and give them to those in need. However, we recognize we are still far from this image in Acts because there's no relationship. While we might be sharing food with those at the food pantry and those who collect this food, we're not there with them in heart and mind, if that makes sense. And that's been a long-standing issue, decades-old issue for the church. It's what I refer to as the food counter barrier. If you ever go to a place where they give out free meals, up until recently, you could almost be guaranteed that those who served the food were on one side and those who received the food were on another side. They were not of one heart and one mind. They were separated, even though they were in the exact same space, right? There was no breaking of bread. So how do we get there? It's not a question I plan on answering, but a question I offer to you today. Another example I would give us is our continued work with being a multi-generational church. And I think this is a wonderful gift of our church, trust me. Because all the horror stories you've heard about kids in churches, all the horror stories that you may have personally been involved with at other churches, are true. People do believe that kids should be seen and not heard. I don't know how that works anywhere, let alone a church. But it's what people want. It serves me just to think about the things that I've heard, the horror stories I've heard about struggling to welcome kids in. And yet, we are too aware that there's a real benefit of being of one heart and one mind. There's no easy answer here either. Trust me. We're all struggling with this. And yet, the ability to create space, to give up what's really historically the most popular part of our sanctuary, the back of it, and to give that up and soften it, what's called soft space, to give that to children, to let our children run wild and free wherever they want to with no judgment. And there's a couple of things as I've reflected just over these last 6 months about this reality for our church and our community, is that I really do think it's a both and. I actually got this from a conversation I was having with one of my professors. But there's a reality in our community, there are needs on both ends here. Most of our children in this community are far removed from their grandparents or have limited interaction with their grandparents and their older generations. Does that mean you all become grandparents? I would suggest you don't do that. I do suggest, though, there is a clear faith-based one heart, one mind sharing of tangible life that these kids need in being exposed to older adults and older communities. And especially people of faith. On the flip side, I also know that many of you, if you live in this space, may not even have kids or grandkids, let alone if you do have kids and grandkids, I know most of you are hundreds, if not thousands of miles away from your kids and grandkids. And in my very brief period of being a parent, I have become a true believer that if you want to stay young, hang out with young people. No, that doesn't mean go down to 4th Avenue. It's not that kind of youth. But just being around and sharing one heart, one mind. Because yes, they will surprise you. Because yes, even if you enter the relationship as what you are, the elder of a faith community, with many gifts to bestow and bless upon all younger people, you too know more than I know that one day you will be surprised to find whatever needs you have will be met in a relationship of sharing one heart, one mind with this child. Being in tangible, concrete fellowship and relationship. Sharing space. And that's the seed. There's the mustard seed for you. And it grows. And for me, it does grow in wild, radical ways. Because not only do we have needs at ICS of building bridges, we also are working with Amphi Foundation to help address the needs of other children in our community throughout all ages in our community who are learning in school. And we also have groups of people in our church working with migrants at the border in our shelter. And how these things get bridged, I do not know yet. I will let you know that I heard God's voice say that this is the direction, and I heard you speaking that this was the direction we should go. I had no idea how we were going to get there. I had no idea what was going to transpire. But just over the last 2 months, I've come to realize we have two members of our church are faithful volunteers in Interfaith Community Services, which is phenomenal. That is building the bridge to one heart, one mind, one soul. AmFi Foundation called us up randomly, and we were able to get a volunteer at one of their major shoe passing out events. If you didn't see pictures of that, it was an amazing, wonderful way of sharing one heart, one mind, one soul with little children who are in need of shoes so they can go to school and not be worried about what's on their feet, but worried about what's in their textbook. And we have people begging me, and I'm grateful for this, who compassionately, persistently ask me, when are we going back to Mexico? Very soon, the next month, I have promised you. It's that willingness to show up. We are not the Church of Acts, and there's a lot of questions about whether or not this was real or how long it even lasted. Even in the book of Acts, we see some contention among such practices and ways of being. Yet, we know that that's the calling, that our calling is to share all things, to share our needs, to share our gifts, and ultimately to be in one mind and one heart with all God's people. That's our resurrection goal. That's our journey to Galilee. And if we keep opening ourselves, if we keep being willing to show up, then we will find that resurrected Christ and that resurrected new way. Amen. And we begin sharing our lives together with sharing of prayer. And today we are going to do post-it note prayer. So if you have a prayer you'd like shared with the church, will you write it down? You should all have a post-it note. If you don't, raise your hand, we'll get you one. But while Jose plays the music, you're invited to come forward and post your prayers on our platform. Let us join together in a spirit of prayer. Thank you. Lifting up the prayers that we have named as well as the prayers of our hearts, let us join together singing the words Christ taught us. Share this meal in celebration. You expose the crucified nails we hold and hammers we wield, and you judge the forces of oppression.
In love, you overcome the power of evil and set us free, oppressor and oppressed alike.
In Christ, you receive our evil and transform it by your grace. You raise Christ from the dead, you raise us with Christ to new lives.
So come to this feast, singing your praise with all creation.
Let us join together singing God's wonder in Santo Santo. We'll sing this twice.
He taught and healed the lost. He gathered the broken and the outcasts. He faced our violence with nonviolence and our betrayal with forgiveness.
He bore the marks of our cruelty and died at the hands of our injustice. He raised him from the dead. Your love in him prevailed over sin and death. Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me as often as we break the bread and share this cup. We remember his death and resurrection until he comes again. Remember indeed your mighty acts in Jesus Christ.
We offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a living and holy sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts of bread and cup, that they may be for us the body and blood of Christ.
Pour out your Spirit on us, that they may be for the world the body of Christ.
Breathe your Spirit into us and send us in your love.
By your grace, may we bear the marks of humble obedience, suffer for the sake of love and justice, and trust your power to raise us up in victory over our own. We pray in the name of the crucified and risen one, Christ our victim, Christ our Savior, Christ our head. Amen.
When supper was ended, Jesus took the bread, broke it, gave thanks, and said, eat this in remembrance of me. Once they had shared the bread, Jesus took the cup and said, this is the cup of the new and everlasting covenant. Drink this in remembrance of me. Dear loved ones, this table is God's table, and these elements are God's elements. All the bread is gluten-free, the cup I hold is wine, and the cup Nolan holds is grape juice. This is so everyone who feels called may participate in this ceremony, in this ritual, binding us together both in concrete ways of sharing what we have, as well as binding us in one heart and one mind. Come, the table is ready. Come as you feel called.
Thank you.
Is there anybody else who would like me to bless with you? Please join me in our prayer of thanksgiving printed in your bulletin. Gracious God, we thank you for the mystery that you give yourself to us. We have seen with our eyes and known in our hearts. We have tasted with our tongues and known in our souls your richest presence in this meal, in our sharing, in one another. Breathe your spirit into us and send us now in your grace, so that through our love, others may hear and see and feel your love alive in this world. If you will please stand for our benediction and our sending forth, you might have an acolyte. They're free spirited beings. Beloved, go in peace and go be peace. Receive the Holy Spirit deep in your being and share your new life in Christ with the world. Amen. Amen.